also, there's a push both for vaccine passports and vaccine mandates. So if people want to have a job, stay at the job, they are required to take the vaccine or they'll be fired. If they want to study at the university, students, many universities are requiring vaccines from other students. So there is these vaccine mandates and vaccine passport, or I think in New York City, for example, now they're requiring restaurants are forced to require vaccinations for people to go to the restaurants. So that's the sort of a very coercive way to get people to vaccinate. And I think that's very bad for public health. One reason is that why do you coerce people who are immune or people who are young who have very small risk when the vaccines are much more needed in, for older people in other places? So that's an ethical aspect to it. I think it's very unethical to do so. The other aspect is that if you force something on people, if you coerce somebody to do something, that can backfire. So in public health has to be based on trust. And if public health official wants the public to trust them, public health officials also have to trust the public. And I've been working on vaccines for almost two decades now. And one thing that we've always sort of tried to do is to maintain good confidence in the vaccines. For example, measles vaccines are very important, polio vaccines and so on. And there is a small group of people who are very vocal, who don't like vaccines, but they haven't really been able to put any dent in the confidence in vaccines. There's very high in the US. So I think we've been very successful to sort of maintain that confidence. But right now, with these vaccine mandates and vaccine passports, that coercive things is turning a lot of people away against vaccines, not trusting them, for very understandable reasons. Because why do you have to force somebody to take the vaccine if it's so beneficial to you? That's sort of one rationale. So those who are pushing these vaccine mandates and vaccine passports, sort of vaccine fanatics, I would call them, to me, they have done much more damage during this 1 year than the anti-vaxxers has done in two decades. And I would even say that these vaccine fanatics, they are the biggest anti-vaxxers that we have right now. They're doing so much more damage to vaccine confidence than anybody else. And even if they manage to sort of coerce somebody to take the COVID vaccines, because people feel, okay, I have to take it because I need to go to university, or I have to because I want that job, or I want to go to restaurants, and so on. So even if it manages to get those people to take the COVID vaccine, it will turn them off from public health. It will make them distrust public health and turn them off from other vaccines that are not mandatory. So it has sort of ripple effects on other aspects of public health that are very unfortunate. And I'm a native of Sweden, so I know a little bit about Sweden. And in Sweden has one of the highest vaccination rates in the world and highest confidence in vaccines in the world. But there's absolutely no mandates. It just doesn't do it that way. It's completely voluntary. And I think if you want to have high confidence in vaccines, it has to be voluntary. There shouldn't be any mandates.
There seems to be a focus on this concept of breakthrough infections, and as if that would be some kind of significant problem with respect to the efficacy of the vaccine. So this is some kind of misconception?
Yeah, I think it is. So I don't think we should be so preoccupied with that. The key thing is that both natural immunity from having had COVID as well as the vaccines, the key thing is they protect you from having severe disease and from death. And that is the most important. We expect that even if you have immune, you can still be exposed and you can still get the virus in your body, because the immune system doesn't go into action until the virus is in there. And depending on how long it was since you had the vaccine or how you had COVID, your immune system might react very quickly, or the virus might actually start to replicate in the cells, so it'll take a little bit longer. But your immune system is still there, taking care of it and protecting you from a bad outcome.
Well, so tell me about this, it will always be with us. Because again, even for me, there's a lot of confusion about policy and what it's actually trying to accomplish. Are you seeing the policies trying to eradicate this virus entirely? Is that even possible? I think you said earlier that it's not, or you know, what should be the goal if that's not correct?
So, for example, Australia has had a goal of eradication. And I mean, you can see it in two ways. You can see it that no, they haven't succeeded because they still have it, or you can say that they've been very successful because they've done it six times. Every time they do lockdown, they eradicate it, and then they repeat eradicating many times. So no, it's not possible to eradicate it. It will be with us. And the key thing is, once we all have immunity from having had the disease or from the vaccines, and usually if you had the vaccines, you're going to be exposed to it a second time, and then you will hopefully improve your immune response even more. That's going to happen, and it will be like the other, I think the other four coronaviruses that we're already dealing with and that we have dealt with a long time. The only two diseases that has been eradicated are smallpox, which took enormous effort, but it was also a much better candidate for it. The other disease we have eradicated is Rinderpest, which is a disease in cattle. But those are the only two diseases that has been eradicated. We have for a long time tried to eradicate polio, and I think it is possible to eradicate polio, and we should continue those efforts during this time.
So what about the countries or states that are in these successive stages of lockdowns? Is this kind of a lockdown forever model? I mean, what can they expect if, as you said, this virus will be in those societies forever? And it, frankly, you know, it seems there's this huge, as you mentioned, collateral cost to doing them.
So the question we have to ask Canada and Australia is, the question is, what's the end game? Because you can't keep locking down forever.